Hello, everybody. I am so thrilled that all of you tuned in today to listen to my interview with an amazing guest. My guest today covers a lot of ground. We get into mindset, why door knocking works in any environment, doesn't matter what you're selling or where you're at, and how to protect yourself and your business from economic downturns. The title of today's show is Complacency is Death and Consistency is King. Get your pen and paper ready. This one's a doozy. Okay, housekeeping. By the way, I love all of your emails. We're getting close to finding our fabulous 50 to kick off our secret, not private, secret Facebook group. And if you don't know what that's all about, we're putting 50 people for free, the first 50, into the group. And in this group, all of us, we're going to share our stories, our challenges. We're going to share what's working for us. And, we're all going to talk to one another. And hopefully all of us can get better as people. All of us can get better in our business. All of us can be better. This group will be capped at 100 people. So I want an intimate. You know, I want everyone to get to know everyone else. I mean, wouldn't that be fantastic? Once we find our first 50, it's going to be $12 a month to be part of this awesome group. So I urge you right now, send me an email. The other thing I want to do, because I think it's needed after talking to so many people and getting so many emails, I want to start building our mastermind groups. And this is where I get 5 people on a phone call, right? 5 people, 5 companies. And we're going to do a couple things. We're going to dig into topics, lead generation, farming, mindset, whatever it is. And every week, everybody gets put into the hot seat. And we're going to talk about their businesses, their struggles. And the group as a whole are going to come in and provide suggestions and help everybody else out. So this right now is on my Grow Your Business tab. And you can find it on the website, superagentslive.com. And we've been generating some interest, but I'm not sure how many people have been actually going to that. We've been getting crazy downloads. We've been crazy people going to the site, but not everybody hits that tab. So if you have an interest in joining a mastermind group, which I either should get a coach or join a mastermind, but if you want to join or be a part of the group, the Facebook group, just email me, send me an email. Let me know what's going on. And I'll put you on the list. Also, if you've been listening to this podcast for a while, and hopefully you have, I think everybody, when they find it, they listen to all of them. You should know one thing. I mean, this is a common thing. It is crazy. But it's critical to go out, find a coach, find a mentor. So for me, I personally do coaching. I have one more slot, and I've been trying to find the right person. So if you think you're motivated, if you think you have the skills, or you have the will but need some skills, and you need some help, send me an email. Let's have a chat. Let's see if we're a good fit. So my email is Toby, T-O-B-Y, Toby, at Super Agents Live. One other thing before we get into this awesome interview. I just did a little commercial for some of the services that I provide. Nobody likes being sold to. But listen, we are all in the sales game. We go out every day. We knock on doors. We call people. And we provide value for free while we offer a service. That's what we do in real estate. That's what we do in business. That's what we do in life. And I would personally feel like a hypocrite if I didn't do the same thing. So I just promoted my services. You know, my podcast is free and it's super high value. And my services, you should know about. So I hope you are promoting yourself in your market every day. On to the show. Welcome to Super Agents Live. This is the one place where you can come and hear the most successful people in real estate. You'll hear how these super agents built their businesses, how they stay productive, and how they stay motivated. Who am I? My name's Toby Salgado, and I made my first million in real estate. Yeah. And I'm your host for the next 30 minutes while we talk to yet another amazing real estate entrepreneur. Stay tuned. Let's go. Yeah. Today on the show, we have a great guest. This person grew up around real estate, learned from his dad, and even though he has a high-end niche, he still uses old-school techniques and a client-first attitude that has allowed him to build a thriving business. I am thrilled to have my friend, Greg McDaniel. Greg, thanks for taking the time out today.
Toby, it's a pleasure, man. I just appreciate you having me on your show.
Yeah. Hey, well, I mean, it's been tough to get you. I mean, you're a busy guy, and I've been trying for 2 months to get you on the show, and so finally you're able to carve a little time out of your busy schedule. So you have an interesting story, and I said a little bit about your background in the intro, but, you know, tell us a little bit about yourself and your business.
Okay, not a problem. Well, like you said, I've grown up in real estate. My father has been an agent for 41 years in 3 different states. So I've been, you know, real estate is in my blood. I heard about it on vacations. I heard about it on the dinner table, everywhere I went. And, you know, I originally, when I was not in real estate, I thought it was just, you know, what dad did for a job. And right after college, I came back up back home in Northern California, and I started working at a medial job at best. And my dad said, "Hey, why don't you come in and start working with me?" And I said, "No, I don't want to do that. I want to go to L.A. and become a movie star."
Right.
And that didn't really work out, as you can tell. 14 years later, after, you know, hundreds of transactions, I have an absolute thriving love for this business, and I have a passion for watching people succeed. And both the real estate agents, when they come to me for advice, and for the homeowners, when they finally get into something that they're going to live in for the X number of years and make it their place where they want to put their head down every night.
Right. That's interesting. So I love that story that you wanted to be a movie star. Right. And when I was growing up, right, we were watching Tom Selleck and what was the show? Magnum P.I. And I realized Magnum P.I. And he got his break at 35 years old. So up until the point that I was 35, I was like, there's still a chance. But anyhow,
I think that boat has sailed for me. But I know what you're talking about. I mean, you always have those dreams in the back of your mind of like, I want to do this someday. And I just tell people, hey, look, forget about someday. Just get up and go do it today. Today's going to be gone tomorrow. So why
that's
not
right.
Make it happen?
Absolutely. I love that line. You know, that's a similar line in those ski movies, Warren Miller. And he's like, if you don't do it this season, you're going to be a year older when you do. So
it's so true.
We're already going off the rails here a little bit. So, so, you know, real estate was something dad did, right? It was just a job.
Right.
And,
yeah.
And I'm sure that, you know, one of the things that held you back from real estate is, you know, working with your dad's tough. I mean, there's some family dynamic stuff there that we've talked about before on the show that, you know, is when you get into a work environment, it's like, is it mom or is it boss, right? Dad or boss. Did you have any of those kind of issues, and how did you get over those?
Oh my God, did I have those issues? Let me tell you, I was the king of those issues. I'm not ashamed to say this, but when I got into the business, I was an absolute, utter, complete nightmare. I was the self-entitled, total brat of a human being. I would come in late. I would come in, you know, stinking of the Friday night before or whatever. And I'd wear flip flops. I'd wear t-shirts. I had a belt buckle that had a bottle opener on it. And I would wear that in front of clients. I'd fight with my father in the office. I would, you know, I'm so surprised I was not fired so many times before. So, I mean, I definitely know that. And there are those dynamics that if you're going to work with a family, you better work that out ahead of time. I'm just thankful I had such a wonderful father, or have such a wonderful father that was forgiving.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what was the trick there? Because, you know, real estate in a lot of ways is, you know, it can be a multi-generational business. You know, what are some tips there that you can pass on to somebody else who is dealing with those kinds of issues today?
Twofold. Great question. What I had to do is I had to go through losing everything that was important to me in my life. I lost both of my houses. I lost both of my cars. I lost all my money. I lost the woman that I loved at the time. I had to go down to $35 to my name and panicking because everything that I held valuable in my life was ripped away from me. And so I had nowhere to go but hard work, and having you had to go back and I had to look at myself and what kind of a human being I was. And I realized I really wasn't a nice person. And so I woke up the next day. Well, funny story, in the middle of the night, I'm sitting there freaking out about money and stuff, as a lot of us do. And I realized that I had $200 in traveler's checks. So I more than tripled my net worth overnight. So we renewed with faith that I could do this. With my $235 to my name, I got up the next morning, I looked myself in the mirror, I went to my wardrobe, and I put on a dress shirt, dress slacks, dress shoes, and a tie. Now, keep in mind, I don't wear a lot of that stuff, so I look like I was piecemeal together.
Right.
But I got out there, and from that day forward, I door knocked. I door knocked every day. 6 to 7 days a week, I would follow up with all my leads. I was expanding into new markets. I was constantly trying to better myself. I was reading books, listening to audio stuff on YouTube, inspirational things, motivational things, reading Success Magazine, Entrepreneur Magazine, filling myself with things that were positive. And that's where the shift took place. It's when I lost everything and I had to become something else. And hopefully people won't have to go through that. But a lot of us have gone through that, and that's where you're in the pain is where you grow the most, no matter how much we don't like that. It's the truth, and that was where the shift took for me, where the shift changed for me right there.
Wow. That's a great story. And I mean, if we had more time, I'd like to dig into how you lost it and your problems with white lines or whatever, but I don't want to get into that. But, you know, but at the end of the day, right, lots of people think that success, there's some kind of shortcut to success. And what, you know, the story that you just told me, I love it because it's, you just hunkered down, dug deep, and you worked it. It's work that has made you the successful guy you are today.
Yeah, it is 100% hard work. If you think there's a shortcut in this business, get out of the business now. Go find a 9-to-5 or go flip burgers, because you will fall flat on your face, because you are going to be constantly searching for that easy button, and it's just not going to find you. I mean, you have to get out there and you have to crush it every day. You know, you don't take no as an answer. You do 100 doors, you do 200 doors, you do 500 phone calls using different calling systems. You do whatever it takes to make it happen. A lot of my students right now are following the model that I had to painfully live through and develop. But since they're listening to my tutelage, they are seeing leads and deals come to them within 2 weeks of being in the program.
Wow.
And it's just purely from hard work.
Yeah, well, look, there's hard, you know, you have to work hard, but you also have to work smart. I mean, it's a hard work in of itself is not going to make it. So tell us, in terms of working smart, you know, for that aspiring person out there, you know, what should we go out and do, right? Let's talk about somebody who just gets his license, or maybe, you know, they've been out there and they've been banging around for a year. I've talked to a lot of guys who now do $50 million, but their first year they sold like two houses, right?
Right.
What are some of those first steps in terms of working hard and smart that you can suggest to an aspiring agent?
Okay, let's break it down really quickly. First off, what kind of a business do you want to do? Do you want to do condos, townhouses? What areas do you want to farm into? So number one, you have to pick a farm. All right, and you have to identify everything about it. Now, you can work with your title company on this, and they'd be happy to help you. But you want to look at three different aspects. One, there's a lot of coaches that say, look, you know, you can do like 300 or 400, you know, houses at your farm. Forget that. That's complete BS. You need a minimum of 2,000 homes.
Wow.
I would like to see you in an upper, a middle, and a lower marketplace to hedge yourself against any kind of market change.
Wow. Okay.
You also need to look at turnover rate, which for anyone who does not know what a turnover rate is, it is the total number of homes in a 12-month period divided by the total number of homes sold. So if you have a 3 or 4% turnover, you're going to do very well for yourself. The higher end is generally going to be lower. Middle and lower end homes are going to be generally a little bit more action in there because there's more affordability. So we have our turnover rate we need to look at. Then we need to look at if the area is dominated by any 1 to 2, you know, like 800-pound gorilla agents out there that have been doing it for 1,000 years and change. And you also need to look at your price points. Like, that's why I say, you know, get a couple of different price point areas. Now, the reason why all those are so important is that if you have, you know, John Doe and Jane Doe who have been working that territory for the last, you know, 100 years, you breaking in and starting to get success in a short amount of time is going to be very hard because those people are just, you know, entrenched. That is who those homeowners are going to call. So those are the first three things, and then you need to find out what type of prospecting or marketing or farming do you want. Do you want to do door knocking, which, by the way, going face-to-face, belly-to-belly is the most effective, but it does take the most amount of time. So you have doors, you have calls, either warm or cold. You have events you can plan, you know, kind of do your social media, social events with clients, past clients, friends, family. You do pop-bys, you random pop-bys by people you've talked to on the phone or people you met on the doors or any other kind of event, or you just work your sphere of influence. So you need to identify those key factors first. Once you get those under your belt, then we can dive in and go down into the nitty-gritty of what to do on each of those to become successful, and then tie them all in together so that you can basically build a very scalable business plan and marketing plan that you kind of can, you can have like one assistant run.
Wow. And so there's more nitty-gritty than that, because that's so much. We can just end the call right here. I mean, that's like, that's awesome.
We have a lot more. I mean, we have to get down to what do you wear when you go door knocking, when to go, what to bring, what to say, how to do it,
right.
You know, but what the best times are to go,
right.
Calls. I mean, same type of thing. Mailers, there's a myriad of different possibilities. How do you follow up with these people?
Right.
You know, what's our next step? Do you keep them all the data in a CRM, or where do you keep it in an Excel spreadsheet? What's the best use of your time, and how to block your time to make it effective so you don't spend all day prospecting, you know? Because you can do that pretty quickly in this business.
Yeah, you know, and it seems to me that so, if you look at all those things, right, well, so what type of prospecting do you want to do? I would imagine that for those different niches, the high, the mid, and the lower niches, the best way to prospect is different in all those markets, right? So pop buys, you're not necessarily going to – if you're selling $3 million houses, those houses have big driveways and gates. You're not going to necessarily do – pop buys wouldn't be that effective, I would imagine.
You know what? I had the same thought a number of years ago. So I went out and I tested all this stuff. That's where all this stuff I've tested, you know, to make sure that it's all true. And one thing I've learned about human beings, I don't care if you have a ton of zeros in your bank account or you have one zero in your bank account, you're still a human being. You put on your pants one leg at a time, and your home is your investment. Now, are you going to have jerks in any type of, you know, economic, you know, level? Absolutely you are. But you're also going to have a ton of nice people on every single level. And I've found that no matter what you do, people want to, they want to know what their home is worth. But then again, only 3% on average of the people you speak with are ever going to be interested in hearing what you have to talk about right now.
Right.
So if you like, our market here on average is about a million to $1.5 million is very common for us. And so people always say, well, you can't go door knocking on a $1 million home. Yes, you can. Absolutely, yes, you can. They are some of the nicest people
right. You
can ever imagine. And I've also door knocked in the ghetto of in L.A. with chain link fences, a highly Hispanic population, and they were outstanding. So it really doesn't matter on pricing.
Yeah, that's interesting. I'll tell you a quick story. So my house is, I paid $1 million for it, and I don't know, maybe like $1.2 million now. They dropped down to $8 million. I live on a private road. There's only 18 houses on our street. And I know, I'm always around here, my house, because I have a big lot and I'm always doing yard work. I know literally like two of my neighbors, okay? But, and dude, I'm a nice guy. You know, I drive down our road. I'm like, hello, I wave. And people, my own neighbors sometimes, many times don't wave at me. However, I was flipping houses, right, from 09 to 2011, and I bought this house in the full-on hood. I mean, it was the hood. It was an African-American. Like, it was kind of scary, but literally...
You're the dog and gun neighborhood, got to bring both of them?
No, it wasn't. It looked like that, but it wasn't, right? It looked like that. But here's my point. My point is this, so I worked on that particular house for 3 months or so, and I was always around there working on the house, and I got to know literally, like, everybody, like, four across the street, right? I got to know, like, 10 people, where, like, they knew my name, they knew where I lived, right? Or, like, the area that I lived, not the street that I lived.
Right.
But, you know, it was amazing to me that the dichotomy, right? Where it was, these people were so much nicer when it looked like it was so much rougher.
Yeah.
So
they're absolutely the biggest givers out there. They're just generous, loving human beings.
So for you, I mean, you work with people, you have this phenomenal system I wrote down a lot of what you said, and it seems like if somebody took this system and just implemented it, you could succeed. But people will hear what you say, some of your students, and they won't do it. So, I mean, you tell me, go ahead, I didn't cut you off.
Oh, no, after you, I'm sorry. What were you going to say?
No, I was just going to say, you know, what is the hurdle? Why can people have all the information they need to find success and they just don't do it? What is the, and here's the question I have on my list. What is the biggest hurdle real estate entrepreneurs have to overcome to be successful?
You know what? It's one small word, but it has such a profound meaning, and it can change your life like it changed mine. It's what is your why?
Right.
Why are you going to get up and go door knock? Why do you want to do these cold calls? Why do you want to get beat up by sellers on listing presentations and go through this? And, you know, for me, a while back, after I got back on my feet somewhat, I was dating this very unpleasant young lady, and she told me three times independently that I did not make enough money for her. And that hit my core so hard. And it wasn't because I'm egotistical and money driven. It's because I couldn't provide a lifestyle for someone who I thought I cared about. And that struck me as being a loser. And I didn't want to be a loser. And so that's why I work so hard. It's not for the money. It's for the, it's if I wanted to get up and go have a nice dinner tonight, I could do it, or anything else. And that's why I've asked all my students that, and I've made them go back and write it down. Think about it. Really meditate on that. What is your why? And once you understand what that is, and once you are fully honest with yourself, that will take you through the hard days, the bad clients, the rough years, because you have a reason. That is the difference.
I love that answer. You know, I was actually just on someone else's show, Jamie Tardy's Eventual Millionaire, and she asked me a question, and I answered that same way. And one of the things that I got to, Greg, was that knowing your why is super important. But sometimes, right, when somebody says, hey, I want to be a millionaire, right, and if once you really break down the why of it, that's maybe not what you want, you know. And, mm-hmm. and if that's not what you want, maybe this vehicle of selling real estate is not for you. You know, maybe you're better off doing being a school teacher or something.
Right. I agree 100%. Real estate's not an easy business. And so if you don't have a passion for it and passion for helping people and everything else, you need to get the heck out of Dodge, because you're just going to be a liability to all the agents who are good and do take this as a serious business.
So what was your why? So you kind of hit that rock bottom. And then again, we talked about you digging in and you've killed it. I'm going to ask you two questions. You pick the one you want to answer. And one is, okay. So I want to know your why. And I also want to know how, I know that you've achieved your why, or you're very much, I mean, you're again, a successful guy. How do you keep on pushing? How do you keep that, you just keep the gas on and you just keep plowing forward?
The way I keep the gas on is I'm never satisfied with what my achievements have been. I'm always looking to be better, faster, stronger, smarter. I'm always self-educating. I'm always asking for advice and opinions of people so that I can give the appropriate time and knowledge to different people. So I'm not going to, try to market or prospect in a certain way. I'm going to ask how people want to be spoken to.
Right.
You know, that is how I keep the gas on. I never, ever, ever want to be satisfied with, let's say we did X amount of business last year. That is not an acceptable number anymore. I have to beat that number, whatever it takes. And that is then going out and networking and talking to people and finding new systems and going to the events and constantly educating yourself. That is how I keep going. My why is very simple. I want to give back to people. When I was brought back onto our real estate team, my two partners, my father and my other business partner, Chris Callahan, when I left after being the tremendous pain in the rear end we discussed earlier, I had hat in hand, man. I had nothing to offer except for my time and knowledge. And I said, look, I promise you guys, if you allow me back on this team, I will work harder than I've ever worked and make sure that I bring value to you guys. And they, with the grace that they showed me that day, I now pay it forward in every way that I can so that other people can see success. I have a young African-American gentleman that I coach, and he was told by multiple top producing agents here in our own company, go give it up. You're not going to ever make it. You just go away, essentially. And when I heard that from him, he's the nicest guy ever. Super driven, super smart, been very successful in the past. And I said, no, that's complete BS, dude. You're going to be able to make this. And I've taken him and I've shown him how to do this. And he's putting the hours in. He's seeing the results. And that's what I want to do. That is my why. I want to see people succeed, both buying the house of their dreams and on the real estate training side, training agents how to put money in their pocket, food on their plates, and making it a successful experience for them where they want to go out and do it again tomorrow.
I love that. I love it. And really, really, you know, it's all about freedom, right? That freedom, just like you mentioned earlier, to have a life that you can either go to a super fabulous dinner or have the freedom to say, hey, I'm going to buy 2 first-class plane tickets to Paris and I'm going to leave tomorrow.
Exactly.
That's a good feeling to go to bed and live with and wake up with.
It is. It is. It's one of those feelings that a lot of people don't have. But once your why is strong enough and you work hard enough and you work smart enough and you achieve it, it is the most gratifying thing in the world. It doesn't matter. Maybe you don't ever want to go to Paris. Maybe you want to wake up, you know, and all the ladies want to go out and go shopping and buy, you know, a $10,000 handbag. And that's success for you. I mean, that's the stuff. That's the stuff that keeps you going.
So Greg, what is it? What is it that most realtors get wrong? Is it the not having the right strategy and systems in place, or is it not knowing their why?
It's consistency.
Consistency.
That is their biggest downfall. And when you have the best plan in town, and it works because you're working it, and then you see success, and you stop working it because you have these deals. And then when the deals are done, you have no more leads.
Right.
We call it the porpoising effect. You know, when you have all the business, and then none of the business. And then all the business, then none of the business. So the one thing that I tell people all the time is be persistent and be consistent in your marketing and prospecting and everything else when it comes to your business. That alone. will make sure that you have business for as long as you want to be in the industry. Short story real quick about that. There was a gentleman who has now passed away, worked in San Jose. He worked a farm area of, I think, about 1,500 homes or something. Every day he went out and he door knocked for 1 hour. He could talk to one person. He could talk to 25 people. It didn't matter. It was 1 hour. Good year, bad years, he made $250,000, give or take. Good years made $800,000+.
Nice.
But it came from being consistent and persistent in door knocking in the farm that he chose.
Got it. So when did you, you know, I mean, that is an aha moment. I mean, you always have to keep that funnel filled. You always, you know, and this goes back to, you know, working on your business or in your business. And, you know, this porpoise effect that you explained very well. That happens to everybody in every industry at one time or another.
Right.
How do you, so you can be persistent and consistent, but is there a formula for not, you know, to avoid this porpoising effect?
A formula? It's a mindset. It's, again, that would be your why. It's why you get up and do this. You have to be stronger than any other force out there on this planet, because if you do not do this, you will flounder. I mean, I guess you could break it down and say, to avoid this, it would be, you know, time blocking. I time block everything into my Google Calendar. If it's not there, it doesn't exist in my day.
Got it.
And that way you can set up consistently being, you know, calling for an hour, door knocks for an hour, call your past clients for an hour, doing the hour of power thing, going by and popping by a couple of past clients or friends or something for a couple of hours. But it has to be built into your day, because if not, I mean, let's be honest, things happen, life happens, and you just get distracted. So time block everything and make it so that it's in that you can actually do it. Don't put in there, I'm going to door knock for 6 hours today. That's just not going to happen. Let's be real. So be real and be fair to yourself.
So let's talk about that. Let's talk about productivity and staying focused on a day-to-day basis. You know, so if it's not in your Google Calendar, it's not real. How would you suggest that somebody structures their day?
Okay. Well, it goes back to the type of lifestyle that you want, right? I tell people this. I say, first make a life plan, and then make a business plan, and in your business plan, structure out what you want to do around the life you want to live. So if you want to live on a lake and sell lake properties and drive your boat to your listing appointments, you might want to find a pretty big lake, you know, and start driving around the shore and talking, you know, meeting the people at their houses. But build that in. But, you know, when it comes to time blocking and structuring your day, sit down, look at your hours in your day, and then, you know, go from there. So for instance, I'm getting to my Google Calendar as we speak so I can tell you exactly what my days look like here. I get up. I'm up at around 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, right? And I get up. I go to the gym. I'm in the gym until about 6:37. I come back from there, and I am, cleaned up and showered and into the office. I get into the office no later than about 8:30. 8:30, all my meetings start. Then from there, I just break it down to 30-minute or an hour meetings, and I just make sure that I stick to it. And if life doesn't work out the way you first set it out to be in your calendar, change it. It doesn't have to be. It's not set in stone, but you got to make sure that you try to adhere to it until you find the formula that works for you.
Right, right. So that's good. That's 4:30 is early. I actually wake up about 4:30. That's just, but I don't do anything until 7:30. I'm trying to formulate a question here, because if I think of that for myself, should it be? I mean, could you? Then maybe the question is, how do you structure your week? Right. So you have meetings. You do 30 to 1 hour meetings. But, is there a way to say, okay, Tuesdays and Wednesdays, I'm door knocking, right? Thursdays, like,
absolutely.
Talk to me, unpack that. How does somebody's week, how should that look?
The perfect week.
Perfect week.
You know what? This is how my day is broken down. Okay. This might help you understand. Let's see, tomorrow, Tuesday, right? Up at 5, go in the gym until 7:30. 8:30, I have my coaching call with my coach. From 10 to 12, I'm doing my Mojo calls, which is Mojo Selling Solutions is a product that is a triple line multi-dialer. So I can dial three lines at once. It's a very effective way to do 100 phone calls in like an hour or 45 minutes. So I'm doing that from 10 to 12. Then I have a blank time from 12 until 1 that I'm going to use for just work in the office, returning calls, emails, so on and so forth. From 1 to 2, I'm following up with past clients. Then I have a 2:30 to a 3:30. I'm visiting a client that I found through my calls last year, popping out to see her, talking about getting her house ready to go on the market. Then I get back around 4-ish. I'm here doing busy work again here in the office. Well, not busy work, but cleanup work that you need to get done through the day, follow-up stuff. And then I have a 5 and a 5:30 coaching clients that I'm with. And then I go home, and then I shut down for the day, and I don't bring my work home with me. Because, you have to have that division in life. You cannot be constantly working or constantly not working.
Right.
Most of the people that, when they're on their deathbed, the number one thing they say is they say they wish they didn't work so much. So I made that choice in my life that I will crush it as long as I need to have it, need to be out working with folks, but then I go home and I shut down.
Crush it. So what about weekends? Do you educate your clients and say, hey, listen, in terms of your day, right? So do your clients say, hey, I'm unavailable after 6. So unless it's an emergency, and do the same thing for your weekends.
Very, very well. A good question there. During the week, I will work as late as needed. I'll work to 9 o'clock at night, right?
Okay.
But then I go home and I shut off.
Got it. Okay.
On the weekends, I have graduated to the point now that I don't work on the weekends. I have to have a downtime. I absolutely have to have it. So unless it's an emergency unless there's a client that's coming in from out of town that needs to see something, I don't work. And I tell my clients that. I say, look, guys, if you need to see something, I can go to the open house on Sunday, or we can see it during the week. Saturdays, unless it's sky's falling, I'm not working. But if the sky does fall, and I, Greg, please, 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 we need to see something, then you know what? I'll say, not a problem, you guys. I totally understand. But please understand that I'm going to be in just normal clothes. I'm not going to be dressed up. Is that okay with you?
Right.
Every single time people are like, yeah, Greg, not a problem. We're going to be in our shorts too. Come on, let's go do that and let's get a beer afterwards. So it's setting the proper expectations up in front, and I've never had a client ever question me.
Got it. Okay. So on your day, that sounds like a great day, by the way. So it's interesting. You start, or at least Tuesday, tomorrow, you're starting with a coaching call with your coach, and you're ending with coach. Then you're passing on your knowledge to some of your students. Why do you have a coach, Greg? I mean, you're a successful guy. You figured out you've had your aha moment. You've hit your low and you dug your way out of it on your own. Why do you have a coach, and what do you get out of that?
Accountability is the only answer that would be correct. Every successful person in this world, and I challenge you to find someone who doesn't have one, that the mega successful level is, has a coach or more than one coach. I think Tiger Woods has like, what, 7 or 8 of them. All the major business, you know, moguls are getting coached by someone like Tony Robbins or Darren Hardy or some of these mega guys. It's all about having that person to kind of bounce some ideas off. They're holding you accountable for the goals and stuff that you're setting out. And that's why you have to have a coach or an accountability partner. Like my coach this year, I, you know, regrettably sometimes go back to my old jerk self and I think I'm the coolest guy on the planet and, you know, life smacks me in the face. So this year I'm saying this. I told my coach, Catherine, I said, hey, Catherine, you know, this year I promise to listen to everything you tell me to do. You know, here's my financial goals. How do I achieve these? She said, Greg, you need to get one appointment a day. And I'm sitting there going, yeah, but Catherine, you know my schedule. I mean, I'm jam-packed. I mean, I'm literally back-to-back. I have no free time. How am I going to do that? She said, Greg, these are the scripts you're going to use. This is how you're going to do it. And by the way, every day you're going to email me and let me know if you have or did not get your appointment. So since the beginning of this month or this year, I have been getting one appointment a day. Today I got 2 CMA appointments. And it's about a mindset shift. So instead of like, oh, I might be able to do that, or, you know, we'll see if I can get to do that. There is no might. It is an absolute must. It is happening today. And ever since I did that, and I have her holding my feet to the fire, it has made all the business in the world. I mean, all the difference in the world.
That's amazing. I'll tell you what, for me personally, I've never had a coach. Let me ask you, so does your coach, you said that you're, so in addition to accountability, you said your coach actually gave you scripts.
Yes.
So does your coach, if a person out there in the audience, they realize they need to get a coach, and I agree with you, everybody should have one. You know, does that person need to be more successful than you? Do they need, what do they need to know? What are you, Greg, what are you looking for in a coach?
I'm looking for someone I respect. Okay. I'm also, because if you don't respect your coach, you're not going to listen to what they have to say. So having your mom be your coach, and she's never done real estate, might not be the best, because if you don't respect her in the business realm or in the realm that you need that respect to be living in, it's not ever going to lift off, you know? So that's what I would challenge someone to go out and say, look, hey, you know, Bob, I respect you. Would you mind being my mentor?
Right.
And if they agree, then you guys come up with an agreement and go from there. But it has to be built on respect.
I love it. I love it. So let's go back. You're giving us tons and tons of great actionable advice. But let's talk about some tactics. So can you tell us one thing right now that's working for you in your business? And I know you mentioned a bunch, and if you want to relay some of the same things, but what's the one thing that stands out that is working for you in your business today?
Going back to basics. I think that a lot of people got caught up in the internet realm of like, gosh, you know what? I can call Trulia, Zillow, Redfin, Realtor.com, and you name off the rest of those sites too. But, and you say, hey, I want to buy a bunch of leads from you. Oh my God, they're going to be so easy. All these leads are going to come to me. I don't have to pay very much money. I don't have to do any work for them. Well, a lot of those leads, as we all know, you know, some of them are valid, but a majority of them are not. And so going back to basics and doing the harder things, sitting down and doing cold calls. I mean, I did a little over 32,000 cold calls last year. I logged about 240 hours in the chair, and that's hard. I mean, that is not easy to do. I mean, your brain goes to mush when you do 500 to 700 calls a day, going out and hitting the doors, getting out of your own way and opening up that car door and going to go talk to that old client of yours that you haven't spoken to for a while and you're afraid they don't want to talk to you. You will be so pleasantly surprised that going back to the basics and doing these things is going to make all the difference. When my dad started in real estate 41 years ago, he was in Boulder, Colorado. It was wintertime. He was wearing what he now affectionately calls his clown suit. And those big old galoshes, the shoes, you know, so you don't get snow on your shoes, out there door knocking. And that would be very easy for anybody to say, you know what, forget it. I'm hanging up my hat today and I'm not doing that. But he did it and he found a couple of things. People were very receptive and his mindset was set in the manner of, I have the cure for polio, and I'm here to help these people.
Right.
And they don't know it, but they're going to love to work with me. And he did it every day. If you ever have an opportunity to talk to my dad, he can make the most, irate individual turn into, the happiest little, person on the planet in about 10 minutes. I've seen him do it. It's baffling, but it's just by a mindset of, I'm here to serve you. I'm here to be something of a valued asset.
I love it. Yeah. Yeah. And I would like to talk to your dad, but it is that mindset you're talking about is super important, right? It's like walking up, if you sell commercial real estate or whatever, or residential, you walk up to a door that says no solicitors allowed, or, I shoot.
Oh, by the way, when I go door knocking, I did not mean to cut you off, but I was going to lose my train of thought on that. When I go door knocking and I take people out for the first time and they see the signs that no soliciting, you can see their bodies like shrivel up and like try to run away.
Yeah.
I charge right for that thing. They are my favorite door to knock on. And this is the reason why. They see no soliciting. Soliciting means selling. I'm not selling anything. I'm out bringing information that's valuable to them about one of their largest investments in their life and how it's affecting them in real time. So I walk up, I do my little intro, how are you? That's what I'm doing out here today. And you know what? People get mad for a second. And then I just say, I'm not here to sell you. I don't want to list your house. I'm just here letting you know what's going on. The pressure is relieved. The homeowners, the door opens, the light from heaven comes down and you hear angels sing. I mean, everything just comes together because they're really friendly with you at that point. And some of them actually start telling you everything about the neighborhood that, that person's getting a divorce, these people are old, that's a young couple, so on and so forth. They're great. They're absolutely great. Great doors to knock on.
Yeah, no, you got it. Right. That's exactly the point that I was going to make is, if you have the mindset of I'm bringing, the cure for polio, as you mentioned, your dad, that whole thing goes out the door. So let's mm-hmm. let's briefly talk about social media. You said that some folks, they instead of you going back to basics, it's working for you. Some folks want to use the new stuff, right? The new agent or real estate portal, Zillow and Trulia, Redfin, etc. Have you done any marketing on those sites, and how's that worked for you? If you have,
good question. A couple of things here. In our market here, we've tried Trulia, we've tried Zillow, we've done Realtor.com for years and years. Majority of the time, we just do not see a good return on that. And that could be our market, and I'm just saying that for us. What we have seen, after I went to a seminar late last year, I went to Tom Ferry, and he said, they were talking about how this one guy was out there, and he was doing some Facebook ads. And I was really intrigued because at that point I was kind of working with a tech team and getting our social media up and running, which is an important part of the business, don't get me wrong. But They said, okay, well, I went onto the site called Fiverr, Fiverr.com, Fiverr, and you can get anything you want, really almost anything you want done for $5. And I went on there and I had a couple of ads created for Facebook. And mine simply read this. It said, find out the current value of your home find out the current value of your home in Contra Costa County today, or something along those lines. Very simple, very broad, very easy. I put that thing out there with a budget of $40 a day on the Facebook ads, and it was being displayed in the right-hand ad column, in the news feed, and on the mobile. So I got that done. I put it up there as a Friday afternoon, and I went out, and I was having a couple of beers with some friends of mine at my house barbecuing. My phone started vibrating, and I was like, what the heck? Where are these emails? So I took a look at them. Within 3 hours, I had 5 leads of people who wanted to know the value of their home. And on their at the event, they said that, they got, like 50 leads within like a week or something. Well, we got 125 leads within a month. And the problem was is they were coming in so fast. I was getting no less than 7 to 12 leads a day. The delivery system was the problem. So back to the paper and binding and getting the information out to them. But the Facebook for sellers is very easy to get people that are interested in the value of their home. Buyers, they don't really respond on Facebook, from my experience.
Right. Well, it's funny. So I'm actually going to do a show in the future talking about Facebook ads. I have a Facebook ad out right now just promoting the show, And I just to test it, I've tried different things, but I just laid out for just to test, right? A $5 a day budget, and it's amazing. I'm getting like, I don't know, 500 impressions a day, and mm-hmm. and maybe 20 click throughs a day. But my cost per click is like 20 cents, and I'm seeing what's happening as that ad is aging, because it's very very targeted that what I did. The CPC is actually going up, but that's amazing. So are you still doing Facebook ads? Is that still working for you or no?
I actually had to turn it off because I couldn't keep up with the requests, and I wasn't being a good steward of what I was saying. I was saying get the information, but then I couldn't get it to them.
Oh, got it.
So I was trying to drive around and send it to everyone. So when I turn it back on, we're gonna be mailing them a lot more. I was trying to go face to face, so we are gonna do that. I'm just trying to get 2014 a little bit more under control, and then we're gonna do that. Our team and I are gonna sit down probably this week and put a plan together.
Okay. Well, we're gonna wrap up here in a second. So prior to getting to the Ask the Agent round, this is a question I don't ask very many people, but you've had so much good stuff. I'm gonna ask you it.
Okay.
And it's kind of a kooky question, but it's, what is something I didn't ask you, but I should have asked you?
I think that what a lot of people need to ask themselves is this. They are always asking, what questions are people going to be asking me, right? Like when you're out in the field.
Yeah.
You know, well, gosh, William, what the value of my house, what the market's like, you know, should I be buying, should I be selling? I think instead of thinking about those, you need to be thinking about what people aren't asking you. Like, is it right for me to sell right now? Should I buy an investment property? Am I going to be buying at the top of the market? Not, yeah, it's a great market. You should absolutely get, you know, buy a house or sell a house right now. Because if it's not the right move for that buyer or seller, it's going to come back and bite you in the rear end. And a lot of people don't think about that when they have a hot client on the line. I had a lady that she was looking to buy a bigger house, and I met her on the calls, and so I took her out and we were looking at houses, and I got this funny feeling. I'm like, gosh, you know what? What is the deal? This doesn't feel right. So I started asking her questions. You know, why do you really want to sell? What's really going on? And I got this as a response. She wanted to buy, she was like a $400,000 townhouse, give or take. She wanted to go buy an $800,000 to a $900,000 house. Great, love the commission. You know, this is perfect. I'll sell her townhouse. But I asked her, I'm like, what, Miss Buyer, you know, why do you want to do this, really? She said, because I'm bored with my house. I said, okay. Well, what are your real estate goals? She said, I want to create a real estate empire. I said, do you think that buying one large house, when we both know we're kind of at the top of this, you know, market near the, you know, middle to end of last year when, you know, everything was going nuts, do you think that's going to achieve your goal? She said, no, but I'm really, really afraid, you know, that I'm going to buy the top of market again, and I don't want to do that. I said, okay, well, let's not do that then. Why don't we do this? Why don't we go look for some investment properties? That'll help you. You can stay in your house, so your monthly nut won't go any larger. We'll be able to create, you know, starting to create your real estate empire, and you'll put some of you'll keep some of your card earned cash safe until we find another great investment. She said, "Yeah, you know what? I really feel good about this. I really like this. You know, this makes me feel better." And so I learned a valuable lesson there. Oh, and by the way, we were successful. We went out and got her a beautiful duplex, two houses on actually, you know, two homes on one lot for, you know, one buy. It's actually beautiful.
Wow.
And we bought it for like $480,000. So she came out huge.
That's awesome.
But the lesson I learned right there is to take yourself out of the equation, learn to ask the questions and understand the people's real why of their motivation, and then be their consultant and walk them through this every step of the way, so that they can get to where they need to be. Terry told me once, I said, Dad, how do I become wealthier than I can ever imagine? He turns to me, he says this, Greg, if you give enough people what they want, they'll give you more than you can ever imagine. And so that's what I try to do.
Yeah, that's Zig Ziglar. And by the way,
this
what you said, I mean, that whole story was, it's what you said earlier, right? Be servant-hearted. So
yep.
I love that story. All right, so we're at There's too many A's in this. But we're at Ask the Agent round. And this is where I ask you questions, fire off questions, and hopefully you give us quick, brief answers that will help move the needle in everybody's business in our audience. First one is about a book. I have $25. I'm a new agent. What book should I buy?
Compound Effect by Darren Hardy.
Oh, I love that one. Do you have an internet tool like an Evernote that you're in love with that you can share with our audience?
I have a lot of different things. I don't have one right at the top of my head.
Okay. And if we had more time, I would have liked to talk to you about that Mojo call thing and how you actually make 100 cold calls. But
actually that would be my number one thing. That is it. Mojo, Selling Solutions is a triple dialer. Also, there is another one, which I am absolutely in love with. It's called Contactually. That's Contactually, Contactually. Ask for Brent Summers. Use my name, and he will hook you up. It is an amazing system that basically you upload all your social networks and your email contacts in there. It will give you, it's too long to explain, but basically gives you 5 to 10 people every day to email and follow up with, so you never lose contact with people.
I love it. You covered this a little bit, but let me ask you again. Do you have any personal habits that have contributed to your success?
Dedication to my success, working in my business and on my business, going to at least one event a year like NAR or CAR or the Inman news events, always continually trying to find more, the newest technology, the newest traits, hearing the newest interviews, and working out in the mornings.
I love it. Yeah.
Keeping my head clear.
Yeah. And that's what I thought you were going to say, 4:30 and then at the gym. All right, here's our last question, and this is a brand new question, and I can edit this out, Greg, if you can't answer it, because it's kind of a tricky one. Imagine you move to a brand new city. You have all the knowledge and experience that you currently have, but you don't know anyone. You have no network. You have no friends. Your food and shelter paid for, but all you have is a laptop and $500. What would you do in the next 7 days?
Door knock.
Boom.
Get out. Okay. You get out there, you don't even think about it. You just get out, you turn left on Monday, you turn right on Tuesday, and you don't stop. My first year in the business, I did nothing but door knocking. You learn the terrain and the people, and you get to go face to face with folks faster than you can imagine. You will have business within, I would say, within 30 days.
That's
and
awesome.
You won't have to spend your $500, I mean, if your brokerage covers your copies that you make at the your office.
Greg, hey, thanks so much for coming on the show. I know you had to move a lot around stuff around to get to it, but it has been fabulous. You were definitely top 10, and I've had Bob Corcoran, Mike Ferry. We've had some great people on. So I really appreciate you coming on the show, and maybe let everybody in the audience know where they can find you, and we'll wrap up.
Sure. Hey, Toby, I got to tell you, man, I've had more fun with you today. Just, you know, shooting the BS and help them. Hopefully I brought value to people. Did you say let them know where to find me? Is that what
yeah,
you said?
Yeah, let people know where okay. they can reach out to you.
Hey, if you guys have any additional questions or if you're interested in the coaching or just want to pick my brain about something, I'm more than happy to help you in any way I can. You can easily email me. My personal email is McDaniel, so McDaniel. The two numbers, 44@gmail.com. So McDaniel.44@gmail.com, or call me directly, 925-855-4186 is my office line. We'd be pleased to help you and hopefully contribute to you making a couple $100 million.
All right. Hey, thanks again, Greg. I appreciate it. And, you know, I'm working on my new tagline to sign off, but it is, I stole it from Tom Rubens. I don't know if you know Tom, but it is live accountably. So it's, well, here it goes.
Ooh, that's good.
It goes, until next time, live accountably.
That's awesome, man.
All right.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, bud. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Let's go. Yeah. For those of you that want to know what we're all about, it's like this, yo. This is 10% luck, 20% skill, 15%